In this video, I will walk you through the import and assembly of a set of trace files. My dataset contains SCF trace files originating from influenza A virus strains. In order to import and assemble these trace files in one import round, the trace files should be present in the same folder, and the file names should be composed of the sample name and optionally the name of the sequence experiment. In my example database, I press the import button in the toolbar to call the import dialog. I select the option Import and Assemble Trace Files under Sequence Type Data and press the import button. In the first step, I need to browse for the files. I select my files and click Open. All files are displayed in the input dialog. The way the information should be imported in the database needs to be specified with an import template. I can select one of the default templates or create my own. As this is the first time I will import and assemble trace files in the database, I will create a new import template for my files. The only source of information available in the newly created import is the file name. I will link the file name to the BioNumerics key field. I select the row in the grid, click on Edit Destination, and select the key field. If I now press the Preview button, I can check the rule that I have defined so far. From the preview, I can see that not the complete file name should be linked to the key field, but only the part that appears between the underscore and the hyphen. I select the option Show Advanced Options and press the Edit Parsing button. In this dialog, I need to specify which part of the file name should be retained as key information. This parsing string will omit all text appearing before the underscore and after the hyphen. The correct part of the file names is now linked to the key field. The sequence experiment names can also be parsed from the file names. I will now add a second rule that will link this information to the sequence experiments in my database. I select the Add Rule button. I select file name as my starting point and sequence type as my data destination. The text appearing before the underscore contains the sequence name, so I specify this parsing string. The preview shows me that the correct part of the file names is linked to the sequence experiment name. In the last step, I need to specify a name for my template. My template is now added to the database. I can check the preview again and see that all information is now parsed correctly. I make sure my newly created template is selected and I can go to the next step. I confirm the creation of the two missing sequence types in the database and the creation of 10 new entries. In the final step, I can specify some additional settings for the pre-processing of my trace files. Pressing the Trim Settings button allows me to define start and stop patterns for each experiment. For this exercise, I will not add any patterns and I can close the windows. Pressing the Assembly Settings button allows me to change the assembly settings for each experiment. I will use the default settings in this import round so I can just close the windows. The final step is to click Finish and the software will start assembling the selected trace files. The overview panel displays the entries as rows and the experiments as columns. Each cell provides information about the current status of an assembly project. In my example, most sequences were assembled correctly and the corresponding cells have a green color. One cell has a red color. When I click on the cell, the details are updated in the details panel on the right-hand side. When I double-click on a message, the assembly window opens. The consensus sequence is shown in the upper line. The individual traces that contribute to the consensus are displayed below. Different calls at the same position results in 5 unresolved bases in the consensus sequence. These unresolved bases in the consensus are displayed in pink. I can look at the curves to check the base calling. I will update the consensus according to the curves. Changing the incorrect base in one of the trace files automatically updates the consensus sequence. I will save all changes to the database. The cell is updated and is displayed in green. It is not required to check this assembly, but still it is recommended. I can open the assembly by double-clicking on the message. At one position, there is only one base contributing to the consensus. I can have a look at the curves to check the base calling. There is a missing base in the upper trace file, so optionally I can update the base calling in the upper trace. I save the changes to the database and the cell is updated and is displayed in green. I will close the overview report window with file exit. This window can be called again with the menu item, analysis, sequence types, batch, assembly reports. The entries are displayed in the Database Entries panel and are automatically selected. For each experiment defined in the database, there is a column present in the Experiment Presence panel. A colored dot is displayed if a sequence is present for an entry-experiment combination. To view the consensus sequence of a certain entry-experiment combination, I can click on the corresponding colored dot while holding down the Shift key. assembly window can be called by clicking on this button. The sequence editor window can be called by clicking on the color dot. The assembly window can be called again by clicking on this button. This ends this video. More information about the analysis of sequences can be found in the analysis videos on our website. Thank you for watching.